limited ability. I'm a limited, yes, anointing. I'm a limited know-how. I'm a limited knowledge that was to turn the attention away. We are not the one that's responsible for making things happen. We're followers of Christ. We are workers together with you. If we're workers together with you, that means that as we cooperate, as we yield, yes, as we become that channel and that vessel, yes, and yield it to you, you will work, you will do great things through us. Father, we thank you tonight. Far greater are you that is in us than he that is in the world. And whosoever is born of God, overcometh the world. For this is the victory that overcomes you and our faith. Father, we thank you. Thank you for every promise in you is yea and amen. There hasn't failed one word of all of your good promises. Your promises are sure to every seed and to every generation. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name. Hey, yes, the name above every name. Hey, the name above, yes, every conflict and every circumstance and every adversity. The name above sickness, the name above poverty, the name above, yes, every scheme and every plot that the enemy, yes, direct against us. Father, we give you praise and the glory. Count it done tonight in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. All right. We thank God for his word tonight. Amen. Amen. Thank you for even y'all looking so inspired tonight. Bible says a merry heart doeth good like what? Broken spirit doth what? Amen. Scripture says something about the broken, see, the spirit. A bad word bows your spirit down, but a good word will perk it up again. So yeah, sometimes you have to talk yourself into victory. That's the reason why I like to just build myself up in the word and just pray the word. And that will always lift you out of your despondency and out of your limitation. Amen. Praise God. All right. I wanted to show you something. Following the example of Jesus, this is in lesson 4. If you don't have your book, I'll just read the scriptures out. You can refer to those. Hebrews 10:5, just turn there. Hebrews 10:5. The thought we want to just begin with tonight is to show that Jesus, the secret of his power, the secret of his ability that he demonstrated or he worked through was not through the power that he had as God, his pre-existent power. And I think that this is the key to really truly yielding to God and seeing mighty works done through us. I'm determined that I'm going to keep praying like I'm crazy. I'm going to keep praying the word until the word just take a grip on me. Amen. That it would just bring me totally under his control and under his dominion. And it was yesterday morning, I think, that when we saw a great manifestation of power. And I had some of these young, sisters that just took over. I mean, the anointing was on them so bad, I mean, so good. Amen. Until it was all God. How many want to get to the point where it will be all God and none of us? How many believe that God can work miracles if we could bring ourselves to the point of praying until we just kind of lose sight on our limited know-how, ability, our past experience? And then, you know, sometimes we say, well, I ain't never done nothing like that before. I don't believe I can do that. Jesus said, the works that I do, ye shall do what? Also in greater works than these. When you begin to think about things from a natural standpoint, amen, you just pretty well just rule things like that out. Signs following me that believe. That people used to do that. I can't do that. But I think the thing is that many times we look at doing things like that through the power of our own what? Strength and ability. And we never pray through and yield through until, how many believe that you can pray through until you feel like a Superman at some point sometime? Anybody know? Feel like a Superman when you get to, in a certain realm in prayer. You lose sight on your limited what? Ability, experience, and know-how, and all of that. And you just step out in the supernatural, and God can meet you there. And that's the reason why many times when people get into that realm, they do things, and sometimes they are just startled and amazed at how God used them. They just stepped out of the realm of their own what? Flesh and limitations, and stepped in the realm of what? Impossible. Amen. Impossibility. Amen. Amen. Nothing's impossible with what? God. Amen. But you have to, it's hard to convince your man that you can do all things through Christ. It's hard to convince your flesh, your man and flesh, that the works that Jesus did, I can do those same works. But Jesus did those works with the power of the Holy Spirit. And this lesson tonight basically is showing how Jesus relinquished all of the pre-existent powers that he had as God, so that when he came down in the likeness of human flesh, he operated simply on the level of a common man. Amen. So he had to pray, and he had to what? Stay before God. He had to do the same things that we had to do, because he did not use those powers that he possessed as God before he came down in the likeness of sinful flesh. And so that is a good thing. If you can just walk out of, even just walk out of the realm of your flesh and limitations and your know-how and your limited knowledge, amen. And, I mean, that's the spirit walk. How can you understand that? And you can just pray yourself into a point, just pray in the word, pray in the spirit, sing in the spirit. Just be very excited, amen, about the Lord, and just let these things that God has said, definitely say it about us in terms of who we are, amen. These things can bring you into a realm where the impossible will become possible. And that's what I'm looking forward toward this year, amen. I can do all things through Christ, not through James Hill, but I can do all things through Christ. Amen. So Jesus had to say, I can do all things through my Father. The works that I do, they're not my works. But my Father, he doeth the works in me. If we can come to that point and get all these weird, you know, thought and notions and, oh, you know, and the negative impact, the negative impressions that we have of ourselves. Amen. Nothing can remove that but the word and prayer. And when we can go beyond that, Amen. We can see God doing great things through us. Amen. Because if you just look at things now, and you look at, you say, it's difficult to reach anybody now. How can you get somebody to actually, amen, sit down with you and listen to a Bible lesson or convince them that they need Christ? Amen. Sometimes we just rule it out. Oh, man, that's just too hard. These people are so messed up. They've been in this situation for so long. Amen. We just kind of what? Rule it out because we feel that I'm not able to what? To help. I'm not able to to measure up. So we got to get rid of our man. How many believe that we got to get rid of our man? Amen. Our scripture says, let this man. Amen. The way of our minds functioning, the way, amen. So this is a battle, and I believe that we can wage this battle successfully. We can get beyond, amen, all of the things that we have already decided that we are not able to do, and say, I can do all things through who? Christ. That what? Strengthens me. Amen. Greater is he that is in me. Amen. Who's the one that doeth the works in you? Who's the one that doeth the works through us? Amen. I can do all things through Christ who what? Strengthens me. He's the strength of my life. He's the what? Light of my salvation. What's wrong with acknowledging that or coming into agreement with that? What's wrong with that? Amen. If you come into agreement with that and begin to speak that and to build that in your heart, amen, the reality of it will become, amen, evident in your body. How many believe that? The scripture, Hebrews 10, wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he says, sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, and thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I come in the volume of a book. It is written of me to do thy will, O God. Amen. So the primary purpose that Jesus came, in other words, he relinquished and stepped out of his pre-existent state and came down in the form of a natural man, was to do the will of the Father. Amen. He always said, it's not my will, amen, but what? Thy will be done. And one occasion he said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Amen. How many, amen, can agree with this, that we are workers together with him? Amen. Amen. How many like that? We are workers together. We are ambassadors. In other words, we are representatives of God. We are here, authorized by the Father to carry out his will, amen, for humanity here on this earth. So it's not my ministry. The Bible says he's given us the ministry of what? He's given us that ministry. And if he's given us that ministry, he has given us what? All that we need in order to what? Carry out that ministry. Amen. So our sufficiency is not of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of what? God who has made us. Amen. God who has made us what? Able ministers of the new covenant. Amen. God has made us what? Able ministers of the new covenant. Because it's all about God's will. God's will. We're here carrying out his will for the human race. And we're working with God, and he has given us power and authority. Amen. Just like the policeman, he doesn't have power to push those cars back and make those cars stop at his will in the power of his own what, might? Amen. So many times they get shot down too, right? They don't have the physical power, but they have what, authority. So there's a power greater than them that's backing, amen, the authority that they represent. How many can say amen? But the real power is what? City Hall downtown. Amen. So we can do all things through what, City Hall? So to speak, that strengthens us. Amen. I like to look at it this way too. I like to look at it that Jesus said that I'm the vine, and ye are the what? Branches. That was quickened to me. I'm trying to get completely out of my limited ability and just completely rely on God to do the works through me. Amen. So I was looking at St. John 15. And see, what I'm speaking about, we don't be sitting here until Jesus comes, and we will not have a single soul to our credit if we just continue to have church and be interested only in the limited stuff that we have been doing all the time. And maybe we got to get out of that realm. Like, we've got to be thinking in terms of signs and wonders. Amen. If we can't do it, amen, if we can't make the impact that we need, doing the things that we have done, let's try signs and wonders. I'm not going to lay man's now. That sounds like something foreign. That's in the Bible. These signs shall what? Follow. That's in the Bible. Amen. But no signs and wonders. You mean just can't do it if we what? Full of our own selves. Amen. All right. I'll sit down. I don't mind it. I'll go home and watch a little TV program. Amen, if y'all don't believe it. Amen. St. John, it was 15. See, I'm trying to get us to the point where we are not responsible for God's work as we feel that we got to have everything in place. We got to be able. But if we would just yield to God and just do the things that we are capable of doing, how many know that we are able to yield in prayer? Okay, St. John 15. Okay, let's look at this scripture here. I am the vine. This is verse 5. Okay, let's look at, let's just restart at the first verse. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that he may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no man can ye, no more can ye, except you abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Okay, seems like to me, verse 5, it says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, but without me ye can do what? Nothing. Okay, have you ever thought about the vine, the same life, the same ability, the same everything that flows through the vine is flowing through what? The branches. So our sufficiency is not of ourselves. See, the sufficiency is in the vine. And once we can get that revelation, that as long as we are connected with the vine, as long as we are in the vine, amen, abide in him and the Lord in us, the same bringeth forth what? Much fruit. For without me, if you're detached, see, if you're not in the vine, amen, then there's nothing that's going to be what? Forthcoming. No fruit can be forthcoming. For without me, ye can do nothing. Amen. Let's look at verse 6. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, my words abide in ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be what? Done unto you. Here it is, my Father glorified that ye what? Bear much fruit, so shall ye be my what? Disciple. All of those are very good scriptures. So you can see that God's plan for us to do the same works that he did and to bring forth much fruit is contingent upon what? Abiding in the vine. Abiding in the vine. Stay connected. Amen. How many can say amen? And we stay connected by carry not the works of Jesus. Whatever he has done, whatever he has told us to do, the Bible says how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, healing all of those that were oppressed by the devil, for God was with them. So doing the works of Jesus, you have to do it. You got to go out and what? Do what Jesus did. And it's going to require prayer. It's going to require total reliance upon him. Amen. I want you to turn to Philippians 2:5. Let this same mind, let this mind be in you. Let me just read that again. Because I want you to see that Jesus actually stripped himself of all of the of his equality with God and outward powers. Amen. And I'm going to give you some scripture that show that. So Jesus was actually showing us by doing this that he was not going to be dependent upon what? His pre-existent power to carry out God's will upon the earth, because that would give him an unfair advantage. Now, how can we follow Jesus and he's drawing from his pre-existent power that he had with God before he came down in the form of a servant? That wouldn't be fair. Can you tell us the what? The works I do, ye do also. Would that make sense for them not to anybody? Let's have a discussion. Would Jesus be fair to tell us to do the same works he did if he was drawing all of his ability from the powers and abilities that he had with God, amen, before he came down as a servant? See, he pre-existed as God, right? And all of the powers that are attached to God, those were the powers that the Bible says he was equal with God. So if Jesus, amen, possessed all of those powers, amen, the glory, the omnipotence, omniscience, and amen, name some of those powers. Amen, praise God. If he possessed all of those powers as God, all wisdom, all knowledge, I mean, as God, he what? Amen. He had what? He had total ability. Amen. But when he came down in the form of man, he did not have what? These same abilities. So he had to start all over and develop these things, just like we have to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that makes it, puts it on a different plane, and you say, well, Jesus had to get his directions. He had to depend on God. He had to pray. He had to wait on God. He had to submit to God. He had, I mean, all of the things that he was subject to, amen, that I'm subject to, he was what? Subject to as a man. Then it kind of leveled the playing field. And then we can say, what? If Jesus did it, if I can follow what his steps, whatever he did, I can do, and I will get the same what result. All right, let's look at that scripture again. Philippians 2:5. It says, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. All right, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. All right, in the book here, on page 29, under 3A, it says that it says, although Jesus Christ stripped himself of his equality with God and outward powers, he retained his divine nature. He still remained 100% God and became 100% man. He was both divine and human. He was called Emmanuel, meaning God with us in human form. Okay, St. John 14:28b, just turn that scripture quickly. Jesus himself declared that my Father is greater than I, showing his subservient position. So that proves that he did relinquish all of those equalities with God that he possessed when he pre-existed as resisted amen as God. He said, my Father is greater than I. Amen. Showing his subservient position. Amen. So that's a proof that Jesus did not operate at all as God, although he was 100% God, but he did not. He laid aside all of those powers and abilities and just limited himself to those abilities that would be common to just a person in the flesh. All right. My Father is greater than, everybody just said, Jesus said that my Father is greater than I. Amen. Does that show beyond a doubt that Jesus, amen, had relinquished his equality with God and he was operating as a man? Everybody agree with that? Say amen. He was operating as a what? Man, anointed by what? The Holy Ghost. And we operate as a what? As a man, a what? As a woman, anointed by what? Amen. All right, now y'all got to be bold. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to what? To preach the gospel. He has sent me. Amen. How many can make that confession tonight? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Nobody. So if you don't, what you call it, if you don't what? Affirm it. Amen. Then it seems like you're operating without anything going for you. Amen. The greatest experiences you will have in prayer is when you begin to acknowledge the very thing that God has what? Declared that you, he's made you. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me. Amen. Some might say, I don't see nothing. I don't see how that will do anything or change anything or make me feel any different. I don't see how that will arise or degrade. I mean, get me beyond where I am. Well, I thought the word of God was quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. I thought the word was life to them that find it and healing. Amen. Don't underestimate the power of the word. So let's just side with the word. And whatever the word says, let's declare it. And that's what? Affirm it or he'll acknowledge it. Amen. Praise God. All right. Well, that was my first observation. I'm just going down the line here. Isaiah 11:2. Let's turn to that scripture and we'll see that Jesus had to be anointed with the Spirit of God and he had to be endowed with the Spirit of wisdom and understanding and the Spirit of counsel and might and the Spirit of knowledge. All right, so that shows that the same way Jesus got his knowledge, his wisdom, his might, his ability is the same way that you get yours. Amen. You have to pray that the eyes of your understanding will be what? In light. Amen. That's the reason why Jesus got up a great while before day and went out and what? Prayed. Amen. So that he would know exactly what the Father's will, amen, was for him to what? To do. Amen. So he didn't know that as God. He had to pray on a daily basis for every situation. He had to what? Pray. Okay, somebody read that for me. Isaiah 11:2. All right, that was prophetic. Then Luke 2:52. Let's read that. It says that that's very a common scripture. So what I'm saying tonight is that these scriptures shows that the same power and anointing that Jesus operated through, he had to do it. He had to come into the, he had to do the same thing in order to operate in them that we have to do as believers today. Let's look at Luke 2:52 very quickly. Okay, now what How can that scripture prove that Jesus had to go through the same growth process as we as believers today? Because if Jesus had some unfair advantage, and if he came here with all of these powers already in place, already developed, already operating, then how can we follow him? How can he expect us to what? To do the same thing that he did when he came down with his pre-existent powers and abilities in place. Does that make any sense? Amen. I'm trying to get you to the point where we can see that if we totally, completely rely on the Lord to do the works through us, we will come out a lot better and we won't be discouraged. Because we were thinking about the opportunity the other day, we were over to, what's the name of this place, this complex, Country Garden Club, and they were saying that they had about, they were trying to find a church that will work that big facility. It's about 400 and something units. And we asked them, how many single parents, families, were everybody families, single parent families, how many? Yeah, what was the composition of the families? And they said that practically everybody over here are single parent families. Yeah, meaning that women, you know, they're mothers and with children, but there are no what? There are no legal fathers in the home, but they are probably men there. Now, when you, they began to talk about all of the challenges and all of the things that it would take in order to be able to get their attention and to minister to them and to make any inroads. Now, what would you actually think? You said, oh man, that's just too far above me. Man, ain't no way we can do anything in there. Amen. You would, many times, you would come to the conclusion that we are not just like the 10 spies that went over and viewed the promised land, and they came back with this negative report. What did they say? We can't do it. You say what? Okay, we're just like grasshoppers. All right, now what was the problem behind that train of thought, way that they were thinking? What was behind that? What caused them to utter things like that? Well, you know, we can't do that. God had told them previously that, what, I've already given you the land. All right? They didn't necessarily have to go over and spy it out because God had already, what, given them the land. But when they went over, that was kind of a lack of faith. They said, we just can't walk over there and take the land just like that. If, you know, although God might have said it, we got to go over, what? Spy it out and see if we are able to, what? To take it. See if we're strong enough. We got to see, amen, if the people look big and bad and impossible, then what? That automatically rules out everything and cancels everything God says. And that's the danger we have today when we begin to get into positions to really help people, especially when we begin to look at the surroundings. Now, all of these areas around, I don't know how many complexes around us that need ministry. And I was just shocked when they pointed out 444 units, they don't have a church that have, and also Greenwood is right down the street. But they don't want it. He said they were doing something else. He didn't say it, they didn't want it. But y'all can read between lines, can't you? Yeah. You do a grasshopper when you see one. So it's easy to come to a conclusion that we just can't handle this. This is more than we can handle. Because for the same reason they came to that conclusion, I think for the same reason we as believers, we come to the same conclusion when we meet with situations and circumstances that perhaps nobody have ever succeeded to any degree hardly. All right, is, you know, I know people that have been working in places like that for years and years, and if you can point to 12 people that they have actually been, I know Sister Jackson that can point to several. Amen. But you won't have a lot of fruit that remain, although you can do a lot of what? Planning. Amen. And then what? Somebody else probably will have to do the watering and following through. But I do believe if Jesus said that these works that I do, ye shall do, and greater works than these shall ye do. I believe if all of that ability has been given to us, I believe that we ought to begin to think at some point that we can go beyond the things which have been impossible to us in the past, and then we can really, really, amen, believe God to go up to a higher realm, and God can give us something creative. How many believe that God can give you something creative when you wait on the Lord? Amen. I was just thinking, you know, this is just me. Y'all can think about something. I was just thinking, I said, suppose somebody like Dean could get a little group of kids together that could sing, or they could, you know, teach somebody to act, what you call the drama. Something that kids would really like, and you would begin to work with them, and as you work with them, begin to share the word with them, so in their lives, and making them, you know, desirous of, you know, making that connection, you know, on a consistent basis until they grow and develop, and if they emerge as somebody that have, you know, that can perfect a skill like singing or acting or anything of that nature, amen, that's going to be enough to get somebody to turn some heads and say, man, I never dreamed that that could be accomplished over in that particular area. So I think that as you begin to pray, as you begin to seek God, as you begin to wait on the Lord, I believe that God will plant creative ideals into your heart. How many believe that? Ain't got no takers. All right, Brother Travis.
Right.
All right. Amen. I saw all of that. nice, with some of the band they had, all kind of activity rooms, all laid out, all of the equipment. Oh, Jesus, everything you need is all in place. And this is what the person that was over the facility, he said that we don't have any churches. We don't have any churches that want to come over here and really work with these people. Amen. So I believe that we're well able. I mean, I believe that we're well able. Amen. So we're just going to pray and just not just pray, but we're just going to take action. And we're just going to let God do the works through us. Mm-hmm.